Sriram is the Managing Director of Microsoft Research India. He did his PhD at Berkeley and then worked for a few years and then came to Microsoft Research, and he's been there for almost 2 decades there. He moved to India, you know, almost a decade ago, and recently took over as the Managing Director of the India Lab. I will not steal Sriram's thunder, and I'll let him, you know, take over proceedings. Sriram.
Okay, good morning. I am going to give you a brief overview of work done in Microsoft Research India. Our work falls in 4 areas. We have work in theory, which includes algorithms, complexity, and cryptography, work in machine learning and artificial intelligence, which is what I'll mostly concentrate on in this overview, given the inclination of this workshop. We have work going on in systems, broad area with programming languages, networking, security, privacy, and we have a very unique area called Technology for Emerging Markets, which studies the role of technology in socioeconomic development. And our lab is very interdisciplinary, so most projects fall into more than one of these areas. And for this overview, I'm going to cover projects in machine learning and artificial intelligence, but you will see overlap with theory, you will see overlap with systems, you will also see overlap with AI for social good. You'll see all of that. So I'll just give you a sampling of our work to give you a feel for the kind of work that goes on in our lab. I'll start by advertising two books written by our by colleagues of mine. One is by Ravi Kannan together with Arvind Bloom and John Hopcroft. And a free copy of the book can be downloaded from Hopcroft's page in Cornell. And this is a very nice book. It covers the mathematical foundations of data science and machine learning, ranging from high-dimensional spaces to Bayesian networks, random walks, mathematical foundations of supervised and unsupervised learning. It's real, and it's now being used all over the world to teach mathematical foundations of artificial intelligence. So I recommend it if you're thinking about a foundational course on machine learning. And this one is a more recent book by Pratik Jain and Purushottam Kar, who might be in the audience. He was a postdoctoral researcher with us, and now he's a faculty member at IIT Kanpur. And our lab has been doing really foundational work in non-convex optimization. And this is a monograph that just came out last month on, and it appeared in Foundation and Trends of Machine Learning series. So I just picked a few topics that we work on. I'll start with this one. I mean, most people who do machine learning would know matrix factorization, which is a foundational problem in this area. But what is perhaps less often talked about is non-negative matrix factorization, where you start with a matrix which has non-negative entries, and the constraints is that the two matrices that you factorize it into also have non-negative entries. And this turns out to have many applications in data science. In particular, here's a very interesting application for topic modeling. If you think about the big matrix A as a term document matrix, where the columns are the frequencies of terms in each document, then, and if you take these two skinny matrices B and C, you could, and if you put the constraint that these have to be all non-negative, then you could interpret the skinny matrix as a characterization of topics. So for example, you know, these are the terms, and the first topic is talking about election, Putin, and debate. So as humans, we could interpret it as politics. Maybe that's the topic that is inherent in there. And for those of my colleagues from Seattle, the third topic is about rain and cloudy. Maybe it talks about, you know, weather and Seattle, right? So the interesting thing about this area is that, I mean, topic modeling is around for a while, but these algorithms based on singular value decomposition, thresholding, and sampling have provable bounds on error and runtime. And not only is this of theoretical interest, I mean, this is actually work with community. I mean, Ravi Kannan works with Chiranjeev Bhattacharya at IASC and several other people. And we actually implement this in our lab for topic modeling for large-scale corpuses and so on. So switching topics, I'll talk about natural language processing. Given the importance of speech and natural interfaces, NLP has gained reinvigorated importance. In most of the multilingual world, natural language processing is very different from what you have to do for languages like English. A topic that people in our lab have been working on for the past several years now is something called code switching, where we look at natural language processing where people mix languages. right? My mother tongue is Tamil, and you know, I frequently mix Tamil and English at home. People mix Hindi and English here. People mix Spanish and English. Most European languages, there's lots of mixing between Turkish and German, for example. So each of those phrases there are mixed between multiple languages. And we have been building a theory and a structure about how to think about natural language processing for these kinds of mixed languages so that intelligent agents like Cortana and Siri and so on can communicate more comfortably with the rest of the world as it communicates with people who just speak English. Let me just show you a speech recognition system that we built.
Tum jaldi se ready ho jao. We have to go for the party.
So that was a Hindi-English mixed language.
Is desh ka kuch nahi ho sakta. It's going to hell. I'm not going to come tomorrow. Main nahi aaungi.
It's not perfect.
Tum mujhe irritate kar rahe ho. Please stop.
So come is not quite right. You know, but you can see how.
Main nahi aaungi. Maine bola na. I already told you.
Okay, I'll switch now to talk about another low resource problem. This time, the low resource is not actually with data. It's actually with resources, with computational power and memory and so on. I mean, that's a ARM Cortex M0. It has 2 kilobyte RAM. So, and that's, you know, you'll find chips of this magnitude in IoT devices all over the world. And today, the common way of using these chips is mostly for communication. Right, you sense and you use these to connect to Wi-Fi or something like that, or Bluetooth, and just transmit data. Right? So researchers in our lab have been thinking, can you make these intelligent? Can you actually run machine learning algorithms on these small devices? And people thought that they were crazy when they initially started doing that. And one might wonder, why? Why would you want to do this? So today, you know, most of the intelligence happens in the big brain that's present in the cloud. And the question is actually, can you have intelligence in these little brains in these small devices? And there's several reasons why you might want to do that. For example, you may have poor connectivity to the cloud, which is a reality in our country, right? Or intermittent connectivity at best, right? You may have privacy requirements, maybe because you want to get sense and you want to give intelligence back without transmitting your data to the cloud. And maybe the device is operating on battery and communication consumes a lot of batteries. Those are various reasons why you might want to do that. So two specific algorithms that our researchers have been working on, one is called Bonsai and the other one is Proton. But the idea is that you start with this. So in all of these, the prediction happens to the device. We'd still do training in the cloud and build the models, but the models are so compressed that they can actually run on these small devices. And so this is how these things work, where you take the feature vector from the device, and you first do a sparse projection, because in a lot of cases, the feature vector won't even fit in the device, right? So you do a sparse projection, and then in the case of Bonsai, you now run it by a decision tree and use it as a classifier. And in Proton, which is the k-nearest neighbor algorithm, after you do a sparse projection, you find the nearest neighbor. But you know, we can't even have one representative for each equivalence class, or many, so we use prototypes, because the number of representatives we can store is actually very limited. And the interesting thing about both these algorithms is that, unlike other approaches where people first construct a model and then compress it to fit on the device, these models are learned with the device constraints as part of the objective function. Which means that the sparse projection and the tree are learned together. The sparse projection and the prototypes are actually learned together. And when you do that, you get a non-convex optimization problem. And luckily, people in our lab have a tremendous expertise in doing non-convex optimization, which is why they're able to do this. And these algorithms got tremendous amount of press in ICML last year. And you know, it has lots of applications. Here's a fun one. So I'll show you this, where people have taken these algorithms and put them on this really small device, which has an accelerometer, a gyroscope, and one of these ARM Cortex M0 to make a cane that is used by visually impaired people intelligent. So let me show you how that looks.
Many times, we are in situations where both our hands are occupied. One could be holding a cane, while the other could be holding a cup of coffee. And using a phone becomes very hard in these situations. Often, we are in very constrained situations, like when we are attending meetings. And using a phone is very awkward.
there are many such situations. Researchers at Microsoft Research India have designed, developed, and prototyped a plug-and-play interface that transforms your cane, any cane, to a real-time interactive device to control your phone and other home appliances. Look how easy it is to clip it on.
Mom calling.
Hi, Venkatesh.
Hi, Mom.
You're coming home for dinner, right?
Yeah, I'll be home at 8.
Okay.
The time is 19 hours, 25 minutes, and 20 seconds.
You just saw how using simple and natural gestures, Venkatesh was able to control his phone. The gesture recognition happens right on the stick. This has been enabled by Microsoft Research India's two machine learning algorithms that have been developed in-house. They are called Proton and Bonsai.
See that? And you know, so with intelligence at the edge, accessibility and enablement, which is what you just saw, is just one application. We are doing several more. I mean, we are doing sensing and intelligence in precision agriculture, where we have balloons, aerial imaging, sensors, and so on, and having intelligence at the edge. There's a project that Venkat and Akshay and I think Jawahar is involved from IIIT Hyderabad, lots of people, and they are now working on how we can put a smartphone on a driver's dashboard on a vehicle to monitor both traffic as well as the driver, and then have intelligence to help with safety issues and driving. Moving on to actually societal applications of technology, I think these are some of the applications, but the lab has had a long history of doing technology for social development. And up at the top, we have several efforts that were started in the lab: Digital Green, 99 Dots, Massively Empowered Classroom. All of them have been spun off. And the first two are now independent organizations that are running. The third is now becoming a product built by our India Development Center, and so on. And these are sort of newer things that we are working on. Connectivity is a very out-of-the-box idea called BlendNet, where we're using peer-to-peer transfer to bring bulk data connectivity, financial inclusion, accountable philanthropy. I mean, you can read the list. So the lab has had a rich history of using technology for doing socioeconomic development. And apart from these projects, right, I think we have really learned several key principles in this work over the past decade. Thinking about the term frugal innovation, I think Bill Thies coined it, which is the creative use of low-cost technology with social engineering, and the notion that technology is an amplifier and not a substitute of human ability that came from Kentaro, and understanding users, and really a lot of flips in thinking where we sort of think about poor as really producers of information rather than consumers of information, and so on. Real rich heritage of work in this area. So those are just some of the things I wanted to show you. There's other things going on about mathematical understanding of algorithms. We have a really strong theory group that tries to understand machine learning algorithms foundationally. There's a lot of collaboration between the machine learning and the systems areas. We are trying to use machine learning to improve our data center deployments. Software engineering, we have a really strong group in security and privacy. It's an extremely important area because data that is the oil behind machine learning, we have to think about security and privacy of the data. So there's lots and lots of stuff that's going on. You could talk to me offline, I could talk to Satish or my colleagues, and we could tell you more about that. We always had a track record of collaborating very strongly with the academic community. Every year, we hold a workshop at the Indian Institute of Science. And these are the summer schools and summer workshops we have had in the past few years. Unsurprisingly, they are all about artificial intelligence, ranging from Internet of Things to the summer school on machine learning. The last year, we did something very different, where we had a workshop on AI and artificial social intelligence, where instead of just doing a regular summer school, we decided to have a one-month workshop in the lab, where we invited proposals for faculty and students to submit on projects that they would work collaboratively with staff in our lab. And the proposals were peer-reviewed. I think 4 or 5 were selected. And the faculty members and students spent a month in the lab. And then actually there was a jury that judged the projects, and one of them was funded. And Preeti Jyoti was the winner. You could have heard about. I know where Preeti is here. Yeah. She her project won, and we continue to collaborate with her. I heard she gave an excellent talk yesterday. There she is. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So this summer we're going to do one on low resource machine learning. So we are going to make Proton and Bonsai available, and invite community to build applications with it. Not only invite academics, we are going to invite also startups, makers. So that should be fairly exciting. So to summarize, actually, this is what we do. And you know, so far I concentrated mostly on machine learning, but every other one is equally exciting, and I'm happy to talk to you about that. And I'll go back to this, and maybe I should take one or two questions.
Yeah, maybe take one or two questions since we already started a bit late. Runners are available. Maybe a couple of quick questions, and then we can get on to the next session. Any questions? Yeah, there's one here.
Yeah.
Can you give the mic here, please? After next year. You go ahead.
So, what work Microsoft is doing for in terms of question answering and question generation sort of?
So we don't have we have a lab in Maluba, in Montreal, Maluba lab in Montreal. So they do. Reading and comprehension and question answering. Also, Eric might know, who else is doing question answering in MSR?
Well, I'll mention this a little bit later in my presentation, but Microsoft Research just won the SQUAD Challenge, Stanford SQUAD Challenge, which is reading comprehension. The challenge is set up to answer sets of questions based on Wikipedia content. And Microsoft not only beat out all competitors, this is our Beijing lab, by the way. It beat out human beings.
Is that the RNET system you're talking about?
Yes, the team in Beijing, Microsoft Research Beijing. But we have question answering is a very, very important area, both not just in research, but across our advanced technology groups as well. Given we have something called the Sartori graph, we like to sort of be able to query this graph, this knowledge graph, to answer questions that are more like questions than queries when it comes to web engagements.
Thank you.
Maybe Srini, you can go.
Yeah. So my question is about the intellectual property kind of discussion when you take these out and work with, say, startups or any collaboration. Just have you faced hiccups on that, or do you have a transparent policy on how you work
with
companies?
So the two that we have done, where Digital Green was spun out as an NGO and 99 Dots is now being spun out as a startup company, we just let the intellectual property out in the open. I mean, with 99 Dots, what we did was actually we open sourced all the things that were developed inside Microsoft, and Everwell has access to it just like anybody else. So those are things that we have done. And now that we are starting to engage more with startups and so on, we will do that on a more case-by-case basis. So we don't want to start with some framework. We just want to work through case-by-case. That's a more practical approach, yeah. Yeah, so I think...
I think there's one question at the back, and then we'll probably conclude. Just take that. Yeah.
So you said algorithms running on constrained devices. So is it developed for a distributed type of...
No. So these are... No. The training is all done in the cloud. And the cloud may be distributed. It could be, you know, we could do it with big data. But the whole idea is that the prediction runs on a small device, and it's not, you know, it's not distributed. But that said, right, you could have situations where... maybe you have an inexpensive detector running on the device. And then you only want better resolution, you might want to stream data and do a more expensive detector in the cloud, and that you could sort of think about as distributed. But these algorithms are running on really tiny devices, and they are not distributed.
Yeah. Well, can we think distributed way of executing a single algorithm?
You could. But these algorithms just run on the device. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.